Hi, and welcome back to our talk on optimization. So we just talked about optimization levels ranging from, say, optimizing compilers to assembly language to hardware. But one important thing with optimizing is we should avoid superstitions. So you might have a myth, like, say, shorter code is faster code. Fewer statements in source code, they don't necessarily mean fewer executed instructions or even shorter. Or even faster code. If we look at these two pieces of code, which one actually works faster? Do you know? Well, actually you don't unless you test it. This is the important part. You gotta run it. So basically we run these, and we run these 100 million times. So this means we get a nice statistically significant tests. We're using old versions of Java, GCC, and Perl. And we can see here that just the for loop, right? Just the for loop. For Java, we've got about 5.8 seconds. And that's the for loop. Remember? This for loop. And we're just assigning numbers. Just initializing an array. For straight line, it was 3 seconds. So it was about half slower, 2 times faster. For GCC, with no optimizations, the straight line method was a lot faster, almost 3 times faster. But with basic optimizations, GCC ended up just being half as fast. With even more optimizations, even more. But then we had this weird case here where O3 makes it go a lot faster. That's pretty interesting. For something like Perl, where every operation counts more because it's a dynamic language running in an interpreter, the straight line worked a lot faster than the for loop, which is really quite interesting because Perl is dynamic and has to interpret every line. So here's some C code. This is terrible C style, which is very common, and it's basically stir copy. This means you can copy one string to the next, and the second you hit a null, you stop copying. This is similar code. Version 1 and version 2. Version 2 is a little faster for unoptimized code, but once you optimize version 1 is faster. So you can see that depending on the optimizations, you get different kinds of performance. I think what's important here is that you should really test your code to see if it makes a difference. This means you have to measure your code before the change. And you have to measure it a lot. Like, look, we got 100 million here, right? You got to measure it a lot because you need good stats. And then you measure it afterwards. So for things like Perl and GCC, a lot of times you've got benchmark tools. There's benchmark tools for Java as well. So do we know if shorter code is better code? No, we don't. We're not really sure. Another myth is that certain operations are typically faster than others. You gotta watch out with typically a rule of thumb. It's not always true. The important thing is you should measure and remeasure the effects after changes. One thing you should be aware of when measuring is that your benchmarks can be faulty. So with constant folding, the computer knows that X and Y never change. The compiler knows that you've never changed X and Y. They're basically constant. And it knows that x times y is 35. So because x and y never change, it can pull these constants out, and it can say z equals 35 each time. So then no multiplication's happening. You're not getting your floating point multiplication. But furthermore, if it knows that z will be the same value every time, look, you're just applying a constant to z every time. So for I less than limit, you're just assigning it. It can just go z equals 35. There's no difference between z equals 35 here, z equals 35 here, z equals 35 here, or no loop here and z equals 35, or letting the loop run. The compiler can figure out that z never changes, right? So it can just say z equals 35. A similar problem happened on the programming language benchmark the big programming language benchmark where they tried to test Haskell code, and what they forgot to do was to tell the Haskell code to actually return a value such that it would be evaluated. So Haskell, in its infinite intelligence, figured out it didn't have to do anything. It didn't have to run the code because you didn't ask for output. So this is the same thing. Zed might not even be changed. Really, the visible output of this code is nothing anyways. So this might actually not be a great benchmark. This is not really a myth, but optimize as you write code. The thing is, it's hard to optimize before the code is correct. You shouldn't pre-optimize. Micro-optimizations tend to have an insignificant benefit because there's an 80-20 rule where most of your code isn't going to be where you're optimizing. So don't optimize indiscriminately. Also, optimizing ahead of time tends to make poorly maintainable code. So the Pareto principle, the 80-20 rule, as mentioned by Barry Beam here, 80% of execution time resides in about 20% of the program's routines, right? So this is an observation. This isn't always true, but it tends to be true. Bottlenecks occur in surprising places, so don't try to second guess and put in a speed hack until you've proven that's where the bottleneck is. This is Rob Pike. He should know. He did the Unix in C. This guy's a smart guy. So trust him there. Furthermore, with the bottlenecks and guessing, we're very bad at guessing what's causing the bottlenecks. It could be your hardware. Maybe your disk is slow. Maybe your disk goes to sleep too often. Could be your operating system. Maybe it accesses something inefficiently. Could be a virtual machine. Maybe it's making assumptions about things, or maybe certain operations are slow. Your compilers might be making different suggestions at different layers. Your libraries might be making assumptions, and they could be slow in different respects. Your language could be slow as well. So an example of something that you might not think would matter, it could be the language. For instance, IO in Perl tends to be very fast because they buffer it and they use very good IO libraries. IO in C oftentimes doesn't beat Perl because it's not doing the buffering and not doing the work that Perl does. So sometimes the language matters. Whereas you might just assume Perl's always slow because it's interpreted, but it's not always the case. So the performance of your system depends on many layers. So how do we find these bottlenecks? Well, use a profiler. A profiler basically reports hotspots, and it gives us information like time spent in each routine, frequency counts of each routine, frequency counts of statements, and the heap usage. So the important thing is when you run profilers on your code, you get to see what they're doing. You get to see how the code's operating. So for bottlenecks, code tuning, furthermore, what works well in one environment may not work well in another. Not all tuning is portable. Another environment might have more data, less data, more memory, less memory, more cores, less cores, faster disk, slower disk, different operating system, different amount of cache, different number of CPUs, anything like that. So code tuning might hurt one environment and help another. Furthermore, your tuning might confuse the compiler, and it might defeat the compiler optimizations. If it knows you code in a certain way, it might be able to take advantage of that. So here's a code tuning example. We've got an array. And we want to return the index of a of x in the array. So if it exists at index 2, return 2. So basically, the simple approach is get the array, get the size of array, how much, get the value we're looking for I equals 0, I less than n. Does x exist in that array? If so, I, the index, is the answer, and return the answer. But you might be thinking, wait, why don't we just return right there? Maybe you should just stop when you know the answer. So version 2 is pretty well the same thing, except we return when we have the answer, and we return negative 1. Doesn't this stop us from comparing? Maybe it's faster. It can be. Another version is the Sentinel version. So basically, we say while we iterate, and while it's not equal to x, we increment, and we keep doing that. And then once it's equal to x, we quit. But if you look here, we assigned x into that array at n. So if we allow our arrays to be bigger, and we put a extra value there, we can stop, right? And we can decide, well, does it equal to that? And then we quit. The benefit here is there's only one comparison being done. If you look at this one, there are, here's one comparison, here's another. There's two comparisons per each loop. So maybe these comparisons are slow. Well, we don't necessarily know that. So this is using a sentinel. And really what a sentinel means is a special value. Like in C strings, we use null. But here, we're just using x itself, so it'll eventually find itself. If we look at the performance of these different versions, so version 2 versus the Sentinel version, let's see, the Sentinel version in Java, we save about 7%. With GCC, we save even more. So this is pretty interesting. So we can actually have some savings with the Sentinel approach. Of course, this is relatively old hardware. So here's something a bit more Java specific, right? String concatenation. How do we append strings differently? So imagine we have these words. These are some test words, okay? And now we want to concatenate them. So we want these are some test words concatenated. So we do this. We use the plus operator, so it's basically answer equals answer plus s, so it's concatenated. We can also use the string buffer, and we can append to it, right? So buffer append, and we keep adding to it. The string buffer is synchronized, okay? So that should be a bit of a concern. This means it's got, it has a lock on it, so only one thing can append to it at one time. But if you see here, only one thing is appending to it because we're not passing it to a different thread. We can use string builder as well, which looks pretty well the same. So if we look at string plus, string buffer, and string builder, we can see that string buffer was faster, or string builder was faster, mostly because it didn't have to do the locking, where string plus is pretty heavy, twice as slow. That'd be pretty bad. So let's look at the code. So here's string builder. We build a new string builder. We call init on the string builder. We call append on it. We keep calling append. And then we call to strings. So this is what Java's calling, right? And then we go to string. So basically what's happening is a bunch of work is being done, and we're calling to string. We're calling append a few times. So this is the inside loop. It's using string builder to concatenate the strings for us, and then it's to stringing at the end of the loop. Whereas in the string builder case, all right, so first one's this one, second one's this, or second one is like this one. Right? We're using string builder internally. And then we only make one method call. So there's no init, append, to string. We save a lot of work. And that's why it's faster. Because basically we're doing a bunch of initialization, appending, and to stringing. Whereas this one, we don't do any of that. Alright? So we end up doing, in the assembler, we do more code when we use string plus. Alright? So oftentimes in Java, because it's stack-based, local variables are faster than static or instance variables in the class. So here's an instance, here's a static, here's a local. Because the local's right on the stack, and maybe the VM can put this onto the processor stack, we can make a gain of that. If we look, we can see that the instance is pretty slow, the static is a little faster, and the local's pretty fast. So you might actually make a gain if you copy an instance to a local, which is a little scary, but it can be true. But you should still test it. We have 1 billion changes. We need a 1 billion in order to make it measurable. So your computer is actually pretty fast. It's doing billions of operations. Another thing you can do is inline methods. So the compiler or you can replace a method call with its actual body. So if you've got int get count, right, then it might make might put the body of that code here. But it's only applicable if the compiler knows that it can safely take this code and no binding will happen. So you can do it inlining. So static, final, or private members can be inlined since they are statically bound at compile time. So there's no overriding. But Java compilers usually do not inline at all. Why? Because they use the JIT to optimize the method calls. So they see if you keep doing, like, if you keep doing this call over and over and over and over, and over again, it measures how hot that path is, and then it says, hey, I can just, you know, strip out this code and make it go faster. Just replace this delegation with some immediate code. So here's an example. We're going to, we have two versions of code here. We're going to traverse an array. So we've got an array list T, and we're going to get an enumeration of it. We're going to say E has more elements, and then we process object. In this one, we do the same thing, except we get an iterator, and we call hasNext instead of hasMoreObjects. In version 3, this sort of messed up, we get an iterator T, right, which will return an object of type T, and then we use hasNext. Then version 4, we use a for each with T, and then version 5, we get the size, and we use a for loop, and we call a.get. So try to guess which one's actually going to be faster. So if we look here, we can see enumeration slow, list iterator slow, iterator slow. It's just as slow as for each, but for get is even faster. If you go and look at the bytecode, at least for this version of Java, the for each loop was just syntactic sugar. Now notice, this is Java 1.5. You guys are probably using 1.6 or 1.7, so this is a little outdated, especially this computer. Like, seriously, who uses these anymore? So another way you can improve Java code in terms of time and space, in terms of performance, is to minimize the cost of object creation. You can use lazy evaluation. So like the singleton pattern is a good one, where you never make it until you call it, so lazy singleton. You can also just not make objects ahead of time until you have to. And you can try the free list thing. It's not that safe, but you can do it if you're worried about allocating. It's a very common pattern in C-sharp games to do a free list. Also, you want to be wary of deep inheritance. Why? Because when you construct something, it's going to call all the constructors, right? If you want more information on this stuff, I really recommend looking at Code Complete. This is from Microsoft Press. It's a good book. It won't turn you wrong. Writing Efficient Programs is also good. Programming Perls is also good. And Java Performance Tuning was okay. All right. Thanks for your time. I'm going to add another section to this lecture where I show how to use a profiler. All right, so wait up for that. Thanks.